I knew all the good things to do. Then one day I found out something new. Changes everything that I think of. Now I live my life for a new love. Ever since I tasted fresh arugula. Something I'd ever be buying. It's better than iceberg. I ain't lying. Kicks the butter red leaf. There's no denying. Beats butter lettuce without even trying. And romaine and chicory are not even in the running. Or your eggs each day. Chop it with tomato, serve it any old way. You can even put it in a vase for display. I guess that's kind of weird for me to say, but once you get addicted, it'll seem okay. And the garden's never better than in the month of May. Because of
All right, everybody. Can everyone see and hear me? Okay. Yeah. Greetings. All right. Deanna says yes. Okay. Well, welcome, everybody. My name is Karen. I am going to be your facilitator today, as well as Maya Stage Managing, who's going to be helping us along the way. And she's on camera too. And I'm just really excited to have everybody here. Make sure that you are, you can see me on two cameras. Yay. So like you get the full 360 view. I'm in my Pilates outfit from the gym today. Yep. You know, I decided we weren't getting fancy today. We're just going to make a salad. I think it's really interesting. I'm in Northern California and it's a beautiful day. And some of you are making this very spring salad in the snow. Maya, is it snowing there in Colorado?
It is not. It was super cold this week. We had some snow earlier. We were down in the negatives for a while, but today it's like 62. It's beautiful and sunny, which is how I like it on the weekends. So all the snow is melting and it's fabulous.
Oh, good. Yeah. Beautiful day here. We're going to get started in just a second. Just to make sure everybody has set their chat to everyone. I am such a dork sometimes when I'm participating in a social. Sometimes I'm like literally messaging the facilitators and not everyone. So make sure that it is there for everyone. And this is going to be a little bit different than what we've done in the past because it is kind of a short one because it's a salad. So first of all, is anybody new? Is this anyone's first cooking social? Looking at the chat, anybody? So, you know, I am someone who loves to cook. I've spent a lot of time in the kitchen. I've done a lot of cooking classes, but by no means am I a chef. So we're going to go through, and I'm going to start roasting some chickpeas. Now, this is not something that is in the recipe, but it is something that is a really nice add-in or a snack to be able to add a little protein to the salad. If you are using, honestly, anything would be so good as a protein in the salad. Shrimp would be delicious. Steak would be delicious. Chicken, it's like a short day. You could get a rotisserie and just pull that meat off and have a full meal with a loaf of like French baguette, and it would be absolutely beautiful. But I thought it would be fun to utilize the chickpeas, and some of you may not have actually roasted them before. Salmon would be delicious, Kim. Yeah, and Angela's using the chicken. And so I'm going to go through and talk a little bit about each of the ingredients as we go through and how you can tell the quality of some of these ingredients, because things like olive oil and balsamic, there are different grades, and I'm going to share a little bit about it. And I decided that instead of using this as my meal for dinner, because my purple carrot boxes are starting to stack up on me and I need to cook a real dinner after this, that I'm actually going to be preparing mine in my jars and layering them up so that I'm going to be able to take them as meal prep for the week. So I'm going to show you how it is I deal with that as well. So I'm going to go ahead and start with the chickpeas. I ultimately don't love chickpeas in a can. I don't love them for a couple of reasons. Number one, I think they smell like dog food. I don't know why, but I do. And then number two, they are much higher in sodium than if you are doing them from scratch. I like to do mine usually in my Instapot if I'm going to do them just for myself. But for time's sake, I am going to be using a low sodium garbanzo bean, same thing as a chickpea. And if you did not know, the juice that is in the can is aquafaba. And you can actually use it as a substitute for dairy, for foaming and cocktails and other types of things. So like if you're making eggnog and you're vegan, you can utilize this to whip up instead of the eggs, which I think is pretty cool. So opening my can, I'm going to drain and rinse these guys. I'm going to grab a colander. And then the thing that you need to know about when you are doing these chickpeas is that if they're not dry, it's not going to crisp up for you. And so I'm just draining these guys off. I've already made a drip. So wipe that up real quick, grab a colander. And I'm actually gonna cheat so I don't have to use as many dishes. And I'm gonna use my salad spinner, which I'm gonna wash my arugula in, to drain my chickpeas. Yeah, aquafaba is a thing. I've seen it in vegan cooking, but I have not seen it. I'm trying to move things around so you guys can see better. I do a monthly cocktail making class with my husband for date nights. And they, because it is an LA-based company, they do a lot of vegan substitutions to make sure it's all inclusive. And so that's what I learned, that you could actually do it that way. Now, if you want to make the very best crispest chickpeas, you're going to want to go through and take and peel the layer off that skin. I am not going to be that particular. If you've been with me before, I don't even peel my carrots or potatoes. So I'm just going to use these. You can use paper towels, but I'm going to use a clean dishcloth to kind of dry these guys out. And I'm actually going to turn my oven to 425. I'm using my air fry setting, but 425 on bake works, but just as well. Air fry, start. So I'm just gonna pour these guys in. I'm gonna remove any loose skins. And these are really nice to be able to put in top of salads, but they're also awesome just for a snack to kind of go along with. And I am gonna use the entire can for this, just because I'm gonna utilize this as salad toppers or snacks for my week. And so I'm just trying to get them good and dry. You can kind of see some of the skins are coming off, and if they're loose, I'm gonna take them off. you can flavor these any way you like. You could do like Italian seasoning, so it kind of tastes like a pizza, or you could use a curry seasoning. I kind of like using like a masala seasoning on these things as well. I mean, the sky's the limit. You could do lemon pepper. I don't know, like any kind of flavor that you like are excellent in these. The one thing you do need to be aware of is that to keep them crisp, you are going to want to make sure that they are cooled completely before you put them in a baggie or in a container, and you're going to want it to be airtight. Yeah, chipotle powder would be delicious. You could totally do a like a chili seasoning, or even like if you're getting ranch would be awesome. Kids would love that, right? Who doesn't love ranch seasoning or taco seasoning? And so I know this is Earth Day. Usually I try to make my dishes a little easier and use foil or parchment paper, but I'm just going to stick these right on. And then I'm going to coat them with just a little bit of oil and salt and pepper, keeping it nice and simple. And in the oven, they will go. Some of these skins are loose, so I'm just taking them off and I'm going to put them in my compost. Go. Getting a little. Got my salt cellar, I got my pepper, and I got my olive oil sprayer, and I'm just going to spray them and give them a little toss with my hands. I like using the sprayer. This is not my favorite sprayer. I've gone through several of them because this, as you're noticing, is more of a stream versus a mist. So it's not my favorite, but I figured I'd wait for this one to break before I cook. You could totally roast them in a skillet, totally, if you don't have an oven available. Yeah. They will pop. So be aware if you have a, let's see if I can grab one. If you got something like this to put over it, if you're going to do it on the stovetop, and these will pop in your oven as well. So just be forewarned. I have not had it totally be explosive, but I know other people have. And I'm just putting a little salt and pepper, going to give it a toss, stick it in the oven. And usually it's about 20 to 25 minutes. Whenever I see recipes, it usually takes a lot longer to actually cook than the recipe. It's kind of like sauteing onions. They always like, oh, just sweat the onions for 3 minutes, and 10 minutes later, they're still sweating. Yes, your dogs will definitely be looking for that popping things. I'm not cutting really anything today, so we'll see if Snickers and Petey decide to make an appearance today. Yes, my husband, that little cover, we don't cook meat often, but when it splatters, this makes a lot of the grease contained, so it's not all over the kitchen and all over the cabinets and such. So yeah, he's really picky about that. So I'm just gonna stick these in. Hopefully I'm not gonna forget about them. And I guess the next section, yes, is Carolyn, is your grandmother Southern? Or is she just a good cook? I have a couple of peas. Snicky, you want a pea? Come here. Come here. Let's give Snicky a garbanzo. Come here, buddy. Let's see if he likes chickpeas. I don't know if he's ever had one before. You want one?
Does he like it?
Yeah, he does. I found out he really likes beets too, raw beets.
Oh,
be careful with that. So, because he likes to take it to the couch, so I don't want him to do that, obviously, because it would stay everywhere. Sneaky, Petey's asleep. He's my little blind, and as of recently, deaf as well with seizures. So,
how long were you going to put those in the oven?
About 25 minutes.
25. Okay.
It's I kind of use my nose, kind of like if you're roasting nuts, you can kind of tell. And depending on how crispy you like them, I know that when you're cooking things for a really long time, that it does give carcinogens, but I ultimately absolutely love things that are a little bit burnt and overcooked. Oh, everybody loves my Snicky.
Yes.
Snicky is a rescue. He, kids always point and go, it's a deer, it's a deer. He's a sweet little guy for the most part, but he had a hard life before we got him. I'm not sure exactly what happened, but he has scarring on his neck from some dog grabbing and shaking him. Oh. And he's really scared of black dogs. So my guess is that was what. So I'm going to go ahead and even though these are say that it's washed three times, I'm going to go ahead and wash mine anyway. Last week I ate some greens that I did not wash. And I wouldn't say it was food poisoning, but I definitely had some upset stomach and so did my husband. I don't know for sure if that was it or not, but you know, let's not test fate, right?
Yeah. Might as well pop it into that little spinner and give it a good wash.
Yeah, totally. And this one is literally the cheapest version you could probably ever get. I think it's from IKEA from, oh, I don't know, probably almost 20 years old for probably $4. Maya and I have a dress rehearsal. We're talking about the fact that in New Zealand and other areas, they do not call it arugula, they call it rocket. So if you're traveling abroad and you're seeing rocket on a menu, that is what they're referring to. Delicious on top of pizzas. I use arugula in my smoothies sometimes to kind of just change up the greens that I am using. It's a nice peppery flavor, but I will say that it is one of the more delicate kinds and they go bad relatively quickly. So don't expect to use it on Friday if you bought on Sunday. You might get lucky, but in general, it's what goes bad fastest of my greens.
I say Sue said that Trader Joe's labels it as rocket.
Does it?
Yeah. And then Carolyn said that arugula was impossible to find in her neck of the woods, so using baby spinach.
I mean, any green will be delicious. Baby kale, a mixed green.
Yeah.
Ultimately just like a very traditional Italian salad that you would get. And honestly, if you look like if you're like me and you use Grubhub now and then, this would be like a $20 salad in the Bay Area. Oh yeah, Crystal, yeah, balsamic vinegar and pepper. Why not? You don't even need the oil. So I'm gonna give it a little spin. Oh, did I overfill it? I think I overfilled it a little bit. Somehow I don't think Snickers would appreciate rocket.
No, I don't think you would like that.
All right, here we go. I don't use my salad spinner that often, but when I do, I'm so glad that I actually have it.
I have one to spin vegetables, and then I also have one because I knit. And so when you soak, you know, when I wash something, I usually wash my hand knit items in the sink, and then I can put it in the salad spinner and use that to spin. It's like the spin cycle in the washing machine and gets the water out, so then I can set it and dry it. So I have a knitted item spinner, and I mean, obviously it doesn't work for a big sweater, but socks and mittens and scarves and those kinds of things. It works really good to get the water out.
I thought since it was smushed down that I could add the other to it. Why did the final spin? I like, if you have kids, salad spinners for like spin art is really fun too.
Oh yeah, that's a good idea. Oh, and Amber's saying she always thought salad spinners were for mixing ingredients and dispersing the dressing.
I'm sure you could do it that way. I mean,
yeah, I was going to say there's.
It's for drying. And I see that cats seem to like it. So, Snicky, come here. Let's see if you like arugula. Come here, buddy. Do you like it? We'll see. Oh, Snicky.
Yeah, he likes it. I say he loves the cooking social.
He's like, he loves. So my dogs don't get a lot of treats because the one who was blind deaf with seizures, we took him camping and he got bit by a flea and it triggered some autoimmune issue in his body. And so he is gluten-free, which makes me cringe because it sounds very bougie that, oh, can I give your dog a treat? No, I'm sorry, he's gluten-free. But he really is. So they only get vegetables. So when they hear me preparing, and shopping, they come running. Unfortunately, Petey can't hear. So, but don't worry, I'll save something for him.
Yeah, okay, don't feel bad. My cats are on probiotics. I'm not on probiotics, but my cats are. So the things we do for our animals.
Oh yeah, for sure. And then I don't know if anybody else orders from Imperfect. I'm doing their Cran Apple Kombucha. Like, oh, there it is. I love this kombucha. It tastes like a sour beer if you like a sour beer.
Oh, that sounds good. What brand is it?
Good. It's from Imperfect, which is like Misfit. Mm. Some people have Misfit. So they take produce and such that would normally not be sold at the store, and you get it for a cheaper price.
Yeah, Crystal says, I don't get food boxes, but my dogs do.
Sounds about right.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think I'm going to go ahead and go into the roasting of the pine nuts. Now, these guys are expensive, and the reason they're expensive is it takes a couple of years for them to grow, and they have to be hand harvested, and there's actually a little hull around that has to be removed. So that's why these guys are so ridiculously expensive. If you do not like, and these aren't actually nuts, they are seeds of the pine cone. If you were looking for a substitution, not that they're much cheaper, but macadamia nuts and cashews are what they would recommend. I will say these do go rancid rather fast. So if you have a Sprouts or something where you have bulk, where you can buy just what you need for your recipe, I would definitely recommend doing that. Cause I mean, I don't even remember how much this was, but so let's say you want to get the as much out of these as long as possible, airtight, keep them in the fridge or in the freezer so that they don't go rancid. And I'm going to take this over to the stovetop.
Yeah, I was telling Karen I made something one time and I didn't realize that pine nuts went rancid, and I made something with them and it was disgusting and we had to throw it out. So definitely don't be like, oh, I've had these pine nuts in here for a year, I'm sure they'll be delicious, and throw it in. No, you want some fresh ones.
They won't be. It will not be yummy. You can see my collection of sparkling water and wine. Our kitchen is not really super big. It looks bigger here than it actually is. We don't have as much storage as you would think for the house. You know, being in the Bay Area, you pay a pretty penny for every square foot. So these you do not want to take your eyes off of at all. If you haven't done these before, you're going to want to low to medium heat, and they go fast and they go burned really quickly. So they'll color up nicely. So don't take your eyes off of them where this is going. I'm going to throw this piece away.
Did you put any oil or anything in there, Karen?
No, it's just a dry roast. This is the same way that you would roast. Oh, you can already see some of them are getting a little bit of color. They'll start to darken. This is the same way you can also roast nuts and things like that. I use the same technique. If I'm doing a candied nut, I will just do them in a dry pan and then add the honey and the cinnamon and those types of things as well. You can also roast in the oven, but this is easier to keep your eyes on and control.
Plus, we've got those chickpeas in the oven.
Right. You're going to see they're starting to get...
They're starting to get a little color,
but you can tell they're starting to dry out, but it's not to the point that I would want. I want them crispy.
Crispy. Yeah. And so for folks who were, who joined after, Karen thought, we thought it would be fun to add some chickpeas to this. So she's roasting some chickpeas in the oven. She put those after she washed them off and dried them. And she put the oven at 425. And they're in there for about 25 minutes, and we've got about 14 minutes left. Just so you know, Karen, I set a timer. So.
Oh, you're so good. I'm going to go ahead and pull them out and give them a toss just so that it's even. Still keeping my eyes on those pine nuts.
Right, yeah, don't burn those.
So, yeah, they're expensive. Like, burn the chickpeas if you're going to burn something, not the pine nuts. So giving these a little toss around, you can see there is some color variation. As I turn them, I'm going to stick these right back in. I'm going to give these guys a shake.
And I saw somebody said, was it Sue that said she was thinking, yeah, Sue was saying she thinks she wants to put some fresh berries in the salad.
Oh, that would be delicious.
Yes.
Yeah, that balsamic with that sweet and then the pepper bitterness of those grains would be delicious. I'm curious what kind of berries you're going to put in. I think I would like raspberries and blueberries, maybe. And I know someone's doing chicken. Is anyone else adding things to theirs? Is there anybody just watching and not cooking? That's okay too.
Oh, Melissa says, I wonder if watermelon would be weird. I don't know.
I don't think so. But if I did watermelon, I would probably switch my Parmesan for feta.
Good point.
That's a traditional. That's a traditional pairing.
Yeah, the feta would go. Feta would definitely go better with the watermelon.
I think usually you'll see mint or basil with that.
Yep.
I was seeing also. I got my health magazine for the month, and they were using the arugula on top of their deviled eggs, and instead of using mayonnaise, they were using Greek yogurt, which I just thought that's like a nice, pretty presentation. Like if you're taking it somewhere, that it looks kind of fancy. I know that in the South, you can see I'm starting to get some color on these. In the South, deviled eggs is definitely one of those things that you take to like a lot of potlucks, barbecues, and parties and such.
Yep. And so, and Katie said she was going to put some tuna steaks on her salad. Yep.
Yeah. I really feel like this is very versatile. I don't think you can necessarily go wrong with it. I thought about doing seitan, but I thought I'd prefer the crunch of the chickpeas. And like I've said, I'm not I'm a flexitarian. I just, my body doesn't love a lot of meat. So I don't. And so I'm starting to get that color. It's starting to get dark. I'm going to give these a little toss here. See, oop, one went on the floor. Let's see if Snickers comes and gets it.
I'm going to say Snickers is going to be like, woohoo.
Yep. Do you hear him? Here he comes.
Of course.
And you know what? Yeah. I think I'm going to go ahead and just take this off. And I'm going to turn the heat off and I'm just going to let it finish kind of roasting in the pan because I do have a nice brown. And I don't know about you, but I never get any of my pine nuts perfectly evenly in color.
Yeah.
If you are, then you're better than I am. All right. So I guess next we get to talk about some of the ingredients in our salad dressing. Bringing you with me.
Man, ooh, Sue is saying, Sue's saying caramelized onions would be really good too.
Ooh, yeah.
Yeah, that does sound good. Love me some caramelized onions.
My favorite way to caramelized onions is to just like cut them up with a little bit of butter and put them in the crock pot. I have a little crock pot that is one I take with me if I'm doing queso to someone's house. And so I just throw the onions in there and I leave them for about 6, 7, 8 hours and they will literally break down into a jam that you could use on anything like a grilled cheese or in a French onion soup, you know. Very, very versatile to be able to have on hand to throw into the salad or anything, honestly.
Or I was also thinking if you had anything like pickled onions or, you know, some of the different pickled vegetables and stuff would probably be good with it too.
Yeah, I honestly don't know if there's any way that you could go wrong with it. So let's talk a little bit about balsamic vinegar. So true balsamic is expensive. And it is from a specific region in Italy. So if you got the stuff, and you know, I definitely like the reduction that you get from Trader Joe's, that is not a true balsamic. So when you look at the back at your ingredients, you're basically wanting two things. You're wanting the must from the grapes and then a wine vinegar. And a lot of them will try to add flavoring to it. And that's the kind you're going to get that are like $4 or $5. So I have two different ones here and I was not even able to get my hands on true, like official balsamic, but I'll show you what it is that I have. So this is the one I normally use and it is from the region, Modena, Italy. And it does have the little stamp saying that it is from that region. If you're unaware, a lot of food in Italy, well, in Europe in general, does have a seal to protect it for other people selling inferior quality. It's wine, olive oil, Parmesan, which we'll talk about in a minute. So this is you know, is good, but is not aged. So I was able to get this guy. In this bottle, you can tell it's fancier, right? You can tell just right off the bat. And I did some Googling on the website that this also has that seal. So it is from the right area. And it says aged on it. So the balsamic vinegar that is aged has to be at least 2 years. I Googled this one. This is 6 years for a very much high-end true balsamic vinegar. It is actually aged for 12 years. And this style, you do not want to make a reduction out of. This is not something you want to heat up. It's going to ruin the flavors of this. This is like the caviar of balsamic vinegar. It's very rich in color.
I put that link in there for them, Erin, that you had.
Oh, yeah.
So I
did research on this. And if you want to figure out like how to be able to find out more about balsamic and when is it good and when is it just like caramel flavoring and such. But when you're paying high prices, it's like olive oil. You save this for making a vinaigrette or something you're just pouring over the top. This is not something you're going to make a glaze with to put over meat. It's too valuable. So let's see. It is a quarter cup of this. And I was going to tell you the really good, the age for 12 years is about a $40 bottle. This one was about $16. Oh, Sue, I knew you would have some really good in there. Yeah, good olive oil, your crusty Italian bread. And I'm going to do a cheater's method so I don't have to stir it. I'm just going to make my dressing in a jar so I can emulsify it by shaking it. And then let's see if I can pour this so that I'm going to take this little guy off. And I wasn't able to get this like at Safeway. I had to go to like one of the fancy grocery stores. I would not have been able to find this in my hometown. I would have to like order it online. And you can see it's really rich and dark in color. It's very fragrant, but even though it's really good vinegar, it still makes me think of dying Easter eggs.
Right, isn't that funny? The memories that come from smells.
Totally. So then we're going to go into talking about olive oil. So I've actually done olive oil tasting classes. And if you ever have the opportunity, it is really very interesting. They make these little tiny, mouthwash size glasses, and you sip it and you roll it around in your mouth. And not all olive oil is created equally. Some taste very green. Some of it tastes spicy. So there's a lot of different varieties. Maya just put a link in there about like what it is that you're looking for with an olive oil. The first thing you want to look for is that it is a dark bottle. This breaks down very quickly. For your best oil, you're going to want to buy one that's in the dark bottle, but you're also going to want to be able to see when it was harvested. And by when it is harvested, you want to use about 6 months out. And as soon as this is open, you want to use it between 4 to 6 weeks. Now, this is not Sue, we know you're a big foodie girl. I'm like, you can be popping on. Give us all your information. I'm using a California one. And the reason I'm using it is because the ones from Italy were old. If you look at the grocery store, some of them were harvested in 2000. So I don't want that quality of olive oil. And when you're driving up to Shasta, there are tons of olive oil trees and they're good quality. When I was living in New Zealand, I would not also use Italian because they would have been past their best date. So I would be using some from New Zealand or from California as well. What else do I want to say about this? You do want extra virgin olive oil. That is the first pressing. It is the highest quality. And I have definitely more than one grade of olive oil. So like my bigger ones, I definitely like this is Argentina, Chile, Portugal, California. So this is a blend. Ultimately, you want it from the same place. and not a blend. So this one is Best Buy September 2023. So you can tell this is not going to be as good of quality because you do want to consume it within 6 months. And then, so this is what I use for cooking. And this one is one I usually use for salad dressing, also an imperfect product. No, I'm not affiliated with them. It's just easy because they drop it off at my doorstep. And this one also gives you the lot number and then the Best Buy date. But I really wanted for this to be able to know when exactly it was bottled.
Oh, Sue found some 60-year aged balsamic on Amazon. How much? She put the link in there. How much was it, Sue?
Ooh, this one is smelling very green.
Oh, it's $230.
I guess I won't be trying that kind.
No.
I think I'm good with my $15. I felt bougie doing that. So we got a couple of tablespoons of this. I am going to give it a little bit of a taste. It's just me who's eating this, so don't mind me as I like take a tongue to the, or my finger dipped in. This is a very green, not very spicy olive oil. If you ever do come to San Francisco and the Ferry Building has like really wonderful fresh pressed olive oils that you're able to sample right then and there, and it's really cool. And I actually did a olive oil tasting class with Whole Foods when the premier shop in Austin had its own kitchen cooking classes. They no longer have that at that flagship, which kind of makes me sad because I took a lot of really awesome classes there as well.
I'm going to check your chickpea. I've got like a minute left on my timer. So all right, check on those chickpeas.
Yeah, this is what I want. See how nice and roasted they are?
Oh, and they crunch.
Yeah.
Hear them crunch.
But like I said, these need to cool down before you put them into any other container. Otherwise, you're going to get the condensation and you lose that crunch.
And then they get all mushy.
Yeah. So they do make, if you like to do salads in a jar, I haven't bought them yet, but I actually am going to, because I bought my mother-in-law jars and a cookbook about like making overnight oats and chia puddings and such. And last Sunday we put together some, like, it's going to be our weekly thing for week prep. And so it's a little silicone insert that you could put in here to keep your nuts or things like that that might get soft separate from the rest of the contents. Now, I saw on Amazon, they were really expensive, but on Etsy, they had some that were really good price that would just slip in. Now, I also know that a lot of people will use applesauce, you know, the ones like you give your kids, you just pull the little foil packet off of. They clean those and then they can set those in and then put them in. I meant to actually grab one, but I forgot. And I really wouldn't eat the applesauce. It can be sticking up dome this way, or it can be kind of stuck inside. So it's like a cheater's way. And it's also a good way to reduce and reuse if your kids do eat those.
It's a good idea.
Yeah. And I know this doesn't call for salt and pepper in the dressing, but I'm going to do it anyway because I really like my food seasoned. My salt well with kosher salt, you can see that it is a coarser grain. And I'm sure if you were like a real, this is my everyday salt. I don't even have table salt in my house. I always use kosher, but I do have like ocean salt, like Himalayan and things like that, that you might put on top of something fancy and flakes, but this is just my lunch for work. So few of the grinding of the pepper. And then that does not go on that. Wonder where the lid to that is. I'll find it in a minute. And then I'm just going to put the lid on. I'm going to give it a shake to emulsify it so that the oil and vinegar combine, and that it is, Katie is a scientist, so she can tell me if I'm doing it right, that the vinegar is suspended in the oil. And I'm just going to set this to the side for a moment. as I talk a little bit about Parmesan. I love Parmesan.
Who doesn't love cheese?
I don't know. Oh, Lucia says, I also think of the proteins, the bacon bits throw into omelets and eggs. They would be easy adding to this too. Yeah, you can totally mix and match. That's one of the things I am liking about the recipes that they're choosing is that it's a base and mm-hmm. then you can add whatever it is that you want. So
I think the one we did last month was really good for kind of like a, you know, whatever's in the fridge, kind of digging around in there. Oh, I've got some of this. I've got some of that. So I think this has kind of a nice, like the idea of putting some berries in or throwing in some bacon bits, or you got some chicken left over from the other night, chop that up and pop it in there.
Yeah, super easy to be able to do it. So I actually trained as a cheesemonger. I considered, I love cheese. I really considered going into that as a career and profession. So I took a ridiculously expensive course, about $1,500 for 3 days to go through and learn a lot about cheese. So I'm going to share my knowledge, but it has been a few years because I decided that if I did go into that industry, that I would eat and drink way too much. And so I decided to go into the fitness industry instead.
See, I know what you can do. I like to eat. I was going to say, yeah, you can, but you can do some, that's why we're cooking with the fun cheese.
So this is like my normal everyday and it says Parmesan on it. But if you look closely and it says it's aged over 10 months, it is actually from the USA. This is not a true Parmesan. I'm not saying it's not delicious. I mean, it still tastes good. This is what I use for my everyday. But if you're wanting a real quality Parmesan, it's coming from that wheel and it's going to have that Parmesan Reggiano marking on it. So things to notice about this cheese. Number one, any cheese you get, you do want to have it come to room temperature. I don't care if it's a soft cheese, a blue cheese, whatever. You do not want to serve it right out of the fridge. It needs time to warm up for those flavors to kind of come out. This comes from a really huge wheel, and Maya's going to throw in a video yep. on YouTube of showing how you actually crack open those wheels. I did get to slice up wedges. And the reason that you are going to want to have Parmesan from the wedge is that, think of it as like you're roasting meat. It ages from the outside in. And so this is going to be like the most crumbly, yummy pieces. And it's going to be less aged as you go out. Though the Italians think this section is the most delicious. So it's kind of a personal preference. Now, can you see those white spots in there?
Yep.
That is very absolutely normal. And you'll see it in cheddar cheeses and several other types of cheese. And before I forget, this is considered a hard aged cheese. How long do you age depends on the type. They'll tell you in the video. I can't remember off the top of my head. But those little spots are when the curds, which have a lot of protein, have started breaking down. And Parmesan is one of the few cheeses that has those two types of crystals, which is just kind of interesting. And it's absolutely my favorite part. I love the feel of that.
I was just saying, like, my mouth is starting to water thinking of how good that really good Parmesan is.
Oh, I love it. And yes, Sue, taking the piece into the soup, save your rind if you're buying this high quality and throwing into your minestrone soup or anything like that. And it's going to bring a lot of flavor and umami in that. And then that you're also getting your money's worth. It's kind of like using your bones to be able to make your own broths or vegetable scraps. Yeah, use it in your sauces. Oh, it smells so good. Now, if you were going to want to pair this with an alcoholic beverage, your best choice is to choose a sparkling. I'm going to grab mine out of the fridge real quick. What did I do with it? Here it is. Okay, so I picked up a bottle of Prosecco. And the reason I am using Prosecco versus, and I'm not going to pop it right now, but when we're off camera, I'm going to pop this. the Prosecco is from Italy. And when you're doing a pairing, it is best and easiest to pair your regions. So you're not going to want to pick up a bottle of cava to go with the Parmesan. These are probably grown within the same area, and the tannins and such and soil are going to also be the same. So if you're doing a Manchego, you're going to want your cava. And you know, if you're doing a French cheese, you're going to want to use champagne, which, you know, we call it bubbles if it's not from the region of Champagne, France. Let's see. But yeah, you always want to try to keep it from the same areas. If you are doing this on a cheese board with this dry, crumbly cheese, you are not going to want to serve it with fresh pears and such. This is one of the times you're going to want to put it with like dried fruits, currants, those types of things. This is also delicious with like a fig jam, like a Manchego or something along those lines. Now, I know it said to grate it. I am not going to grate it. I'm going to shave it. I like the texture when I shave it because I get those little crystal bits. I'm putting this back in the fridge so it's nice and perfect for me when I'm done.
We know what Karen's doing after the social.
You know it. You know it. Okay. So I'm going to do my shavers. And I am a girl who literally grew up with Parmesan in a can. So
I was going to say my sister-in-law said she didn't realize Parmesan was anything other than that powder stuff in the green can until she was like in her mid-20s. Had gone to a fancy restaurant. They're like, oh, do you want some Parmesan? And she's like, sure. And then they're, you know, they're shaving it on. And she's like, what is that?
Right. Yeah, totally. And I didn't know that. Like, I thought when you went to Olive Garden, and you're going to laugh at me because I still absolutely love Olive Garden, I thought that they were shaving Parmesan. It's not Parmesan. It's Romano that they're actually shaving when they put it over your food. Now, if you ever have the opportunity to eat pasta that has been tossed in that actual wheel where they just put the cracked pepper and they like shave the wheel and get all the cheese and then toss the hot pasta in it, it's absolutely fabulous. Like I had the opportunity to do that when I was in Sydney for a while, and it is absolutely delicious. I'm going to use my Y peeler, and this is, it doesn't have any like little pieces in here, and I'm just going to do those shavings. You can also use this to do chocolate shavings as well. And I just think it tastes better. You can see, let me see if I can get this. See what I'm doing. So look at that, it's pretty. It looks fancy too. Like if you're having company, this is gonna look fancier. Oh, and I was gonna say, yes, it is Parmesan in the little can when it's pre-shredded, but you don't actually want to buy that kind. Any, I think I mentioned in the last cooking social, anything that is pre-crumbled, I don't care if it's blue cheese, feta or whatever, if you can get a block, that's what you're gonna want because those are what has fallen off. It's like literally the discard that they're selling you.
And plus they usually put a lot of weird things in it to keep it from like completely drying out. So yeah, I mean, don't get me wrong, sometimes in a pinch I'll buy something that's already been shredded or done because I'm like, I don't have time for this. But yeah, if you can shred it yourself or cut it,
I mean, I've definitely in the last year bought some that was pre-shredded. Snickers, you're not getting any of this. This is expensive cheese. Sorry, dude. You get Velveeta with your pills. So I guess it's about time to start assembling my salad. Last thing that we need to do is to do your cheese microplaning. Microplane here. And literally you're just trying to keep as much white pith out of it because it becomes bitter. So I'm going to make a little pile here. I'm using that microplane. I know that this is also how I do my ginger when it's frozen, which we did last time, or my garlic. Oh, it smells so good. Is something going on? Is there tornadoes?
Yeah, I think Evangeline, well, she was having some connection issues and now she says she's trying to figure out what's going on around her grandparents in another part of town. There's a high police presence, and they are also walking around with their larger guns.
Oh, God.
So I'm hoping everything is okay. Oh my God. In Norwich, Connecticut, Industrial Park. So I hope everything's okay there. Gosh.
That's scary. It's kind of like when we've had people log off socials for tornadoes and such to go into the
city. Yeah.
So I'm going to start layering my jars for my salads. So you can already see that it started to separate. Can you see the layers?
Yep.
A little bit. There's a glare. I'm like, so I'm going to get and I'm going to layer, because when you do the salads in the jar, you always put the dressing in at the beginning. I think my husband's going to be disappointed that I'm taking this for lunch and he's not eating it.
I was going to say, he's going to be like, that's not fair.
Right. So pouring that in, and then I am going to just layer in my arugula. I'm going to top with the Parmesan and pine nuts, and then I can just take a bowl with me to work, dump it in. I am not going to put my chickpeas in here. I don't like when I put them in the refrigerator. When they're dry, I'm going to put them in a baggie or Tupperware, glass Tupperware or something, and leave it on the counter. And you want to make sure your arugula is dry if you're not eating it right away. I'm just going to stuff it into my jar. Yeah, this would be like a $30 salad.
Oh, yeah, easily.
Delivered. And yeah, I've done that too.
And then yeah, Sue's saying that she would keep the pine nuts separate too if you're not eating it right away. Because yeah. Especially since those are toasted, those might get a little...
I'm going to take a little Tupperware and put it separate. I am going to throw my lemon zest on top, because when I dump this, I can definitely mix it all together.
Can you hold that mason jar up? So Kim can kind of see. Yeah. So she's putting it in a jar. So she's going to take it for lunch. So this is a great idea. Make the salad, make the little jar salads, kind of layer everything in. And then you've got a nice little meal prep for the week. You can just grab your jar and go.
Yeah, and I actually, for my lunchbox, my husband laughed at me. I bought silverware that attaches to it so that it has like a straw and chopsticks and a knife and a fork. That way I'm not forgetting to take mine and using the plastic kind of work.
Oh, and Carolyn says she just posted a pic of her salad in Sonder Club, ready to dig in.
Ooh, yum. So yeah, super simple, super easy. And then I'm going to put the pine nuts and such in a little separate container. I'm just going to carry that separate with me. I can't wait to see everybody's photos of their salads.
Yeah, be sure and tell us if you put something else, you know, some other things. And yeah, Kim, she put the dressing on the bottom in the jar and then is putting the arugula in and then you're putting the cheese in and then a little bit of that lemon peel. Lemon zest.
I'll see how the lemon zest holds up. I've never used it in this manner before, so it may dry out, but since it is an enclosed sealed container, I think it should be okay. And then I'm just topping it off with my Parmesan, putting the cheese up at the top. I did do salads like this last week, and I just layered Trader Joe's has these little marinated chickpeas. And so I made a lemon vinaigrette and I put that down and then I put the chickpeas and then I layered mushrooms right on top. And I made them Sunday and I didn't eat one of them until last night. And the mushrooms turned out perfectly marinated from the marinated chickpeas and dressing. So if you're making those, super delicious. Oh, I love Parmesan. And so now I got these little guys ready to go. And then I'm just going to grab a little Tupperware and then I'm going to throw my pine nuts and chickpeas in those.
So I saw, let's see, Angela, were you cooking? I know sometimes you are cooking along with us. Were you, did you make the salad too? Yep. She says, yep. Thumbs up. She's like ready to eat.
Me too. So I'm going to keep my pine nuts separate. Because I might use these in other things as I go through the week. Because you can add these on smoothie bowls. anything you want a little extra crunch on. And if you are someone who likes to bake, there's some Italian cookies that use pine nuts in them. And of course, the traditional way is to use it in a pesto. Depending on where you are right now, you may or may not have access to a lot of fresh basil. So I'm going to keep these. I'm not going to refrigerate them. And then do the same thing with my chickpeas. I'm just going to put them in a big container. And then when I'm ready for to take them with lunch, I'm going to put them into a baggie or another smaller container. It's just the dog's pills have the smaller container, right? Or the Velveeta cheese for the dog's pills has the container that I want right at the moment. Well, one pill. Oh, Snicky's coming.
I was going to say, did he hear the chickpea hit the floor?
Oh, yeah, he's very happy. So there we go. There is meal prep for a couple of days.
Nice. And you could even make, I mean, if you did like a double batch, you could make, you know, if you have lots of those little jars, you could make multiple ones. And then if you've got like your berries that some people were going to use, or you've got your chicken or whatever else, you can just pop those right on there. Delicious.
Yeah, I love these. I got these at Target. I felt so grown up buying them. Instead of just Gladware or something like that, it's better for glass and such. But yeah, I really like these. I did it for a soup challenge that I did so I could like freeze some of the soups or be able to take them with me to work and such.
Oh, this is fun. Carolyn said her vegetable hating husband is trying everything that she makes during these socials and she's expanding his horizons. That's awesome.
That's awesome. I mean, love it's also it. To be able to give tasters to your kids too. I have to admit the first time I had vinaigrette, I was probably 13 and it was definitely too pungent because, you know, as you age, your taste buds kind of dull a bit. So
that your taste buds completely regenerate every 3 weeks.
I did so not if, know.
Yeah. So if you're like when you're trying to cut back on sugar or trying to cut back on stuff, you have to give yourself 3 weeks because your taste buds have gotten used to like a certain level of sweetness or a certain level of salt. So you have to give yourself like 3 weeks for your taste buds to kind of chill and accept something new. I guess you could burn them all with a hot soup or coffee, but I don't think that's really the best, best way to go. But yeah, 3 weeks for new taste buds.
That's interesting. That's really cool.
I know.
So we're done with the cooking portion of our segment. But we do want to do one more thing before we disconnect for today. I don't know if you guys saw Meha's post this week for International Women's Day. They're trying to do a big push of breaking up with the perfect. And, you know, we're going to recognize that being a woman can definitely include non-binary. Like, I mean, we're not trying to be...
exclusionary.
Yes, by no means. But everybody has some woman in their life that has influenced them one way or the other. And as women, a lot of times we really do try to take care of everybody else before we fill our own cup, right? And so she shared a video of her breaking up with the perfect. And you'll see she had naturally wavy hair and she came on camera and her hair was not perfectly styled and she was okay with breaking up the perfect. And so Maya and I are going to share ways that we have recently been breaking up with the perfect. And then we're going to give you guys the opportunity to either come on camera, don't flip out, you don't have to come on camera, or share in the chat of ways that you have been breaking up with the perfect recently. The way we'll go about it is Maya will call on people whose hands are raised who want to come on, or we'll share commentary from the chat. So for myself, one of the ways that I'm breaking up with the perfect is that those of you who have joined some of my socials since the New Year's know that I got pretty sick, still tested negative for COVID. And then you can totally tell my cat is open. But I have a feeling that's actually what it was because I still have one toe that's a little swollen with COVID toes. And because of that, with a job as a fitness instructor that's very physical, I was trying to juggle a lot of things and putting myself absolutely last. And I will be the first to admit that my journal has been, I set it up for the month, but it's pretty late at this moment for those habit tracking and such. And so what I did is I really decided that I needed to take time to heal, for my energy to come back and do all the things that I needed to do. And so I actually quit one of my jobs of head of Group X to be able to give myself the time and space to be able to heal. And that's kind of new for me because I always worry about putting more on other people's plates instead of worrying about my own. So that's one way that I'm breaking up with the perfect. Maya, how about you?
Nice. I think that one of the things that I've been trying to do is I was kind of raised with the idea that I should do everything and always add new things and always be doing like 50 million things. And so my breaking up with the perfect is kind of similar to what yours is, as I've been, this year has kind of been, my theme has kind of been subtraction. So I'm figuring out what things can I take away, or what things can I subtract? What things can I not do? Instead of adding, I've been reading some interesting articles talking about humans are very quick to add things that they think are going to make things better, but they're not as quick to subtract things. So sometimes I'm like, okay, maybe I need to subtract, you know, cooking dinner every night. Maybe it's okay to have the meal boxes, or to, you know, if we are, or do meal prep, right, instead of trying to come up with something new. So I think that's kind of how I've been trying to do that, not trying to do everything, and trying to find things that I can subtract. And it may not be perfect, but I think that's kind of, it's been working out pretty well, right? I think I was telling some folks, I always tell everybody in the weekly setup that I try to like unsubscribe from emails, and like I spend some time doing, that's one of my habits that I have, is like I spend 5 minutes every morning unsubscribing from things. It works out so nicely with my email box. So sometimes when you're thinking like things, I need to change things up, I need to shake things up, instead of adding something to your plate, think about subtracting something and see how that feels.
Yeah, I saw a meme, or like one of the inspirational quotes on Facebook, that was talking about that sometimes we need less, not more. And that just really aligns with what it was that you were talking about. Now we're going to leave it open for you to either utilize in the chat, or if you're comfortable coming up on camera, we're not judging if you're in pajamas or if you have dishes in your sink. I have dishes in my sink. So who is willing to share how they are breaking up with the perfect?
I saw Sophia raised her hand. Sophia, do you want to hop on?
Sure, I'll hop on. So one of the things that brought up that particular journaling, the daily ritual, was how often I will, like this week in particular, my house, I have 5 kids, I have 2 toddlers, I'm a homeschool mom, and laundry hasn't been folded very much. And I was thinking, my kids had tennis and it got canceled because of rain. And I thought I should still invite some friends from tennis to come over and hang out so the kids can still spend time. And then I looked at my couch and saw the laundry that was on my couch. And I thought, oh, maybe I'm not going to do that because there's laundry on my couch. And then I thought, it's okay. They won't care. Like, I'm the only one that cares about this. They're not going to care that there's laundry on my couch. And we invited the friends and had a good conversation, and the kids got together. And then later that week, my mother-in-law called to ask if she could help out in any way, if she could come over to help out. And at first I was like, oh, I need to clean the house before she comes. And I thought, that's why she's coming, is to help. I don't need to like have the house clean to have her come help me clean the house. Like, so I've just been working on not feeling that I have to have everything perfect in order to be around people or have people be in my space. And accepting that right now, that is my reality right now. And that if people care about me, they understand that. And I don't have to have everything looking perfect. If you could see the other side, I'll even show you the other side real quick. This is my living room right now. We've got all the toys.
How many kids did you say you had? 5?
I have 5.
But yeah.
And that's just what it is. And it's like, yep. And that's my 1-year-old in the background. And there's my 3-year-old. Because mom's doing something on a screen, they all have to be here. So
yes, absolutely. Anyway,
that's my share. Thanks.
Thank you so much for being vulnerable and sharing. That was amazing. And I know that it definitely is going to resonate with a lot of people here.
All right. Katie has raised her hand. Katie.
Hi. Super fun social. I didn't participate too much. I just sat here and drank. So I was joining you for that. Way I'm breaking up with perfection is I actually have a book that I'm starting to ask for help. And it's, I didn't do the thing today, letting go of productivity guilt. Because I fell into that category. And this week I certainly made a little bit of an extra effort of, I walked away from what I couldn't fix or solve at the time, because I needed to do that. And I am working on not feeling bad about it. So that is how I'm breaking up with perfection.
Thank you. Yay.
And if you recognize her face, you'll see her in our social. She's one of our facilitators too. And we love her. And apparently I'm very jealous that I did not make it to yesterday's, because apparently it was phenomenal.
Was that was the rainbow one, wasn't it? The Wonder yeah. Rainbow. There is one more of those. So yes, I was there, but I was quiet. So yeah, the Wonder Rainbow social is awesome. So if you haven't signed up for that one, take a look and check that out. So, Katie, Amber's asking, is it a workbook or a regular book?
It is a regular book. I will put the author and the book title in there, but.
Perfect. Thank you. All right. I saw Julia has her hand up. Julia, would you like to come on and share with us?
Hi, everyone. I am very new and scarily entering into the world of considering myself an artist. And last week I applied for an art job that I'm not qualified for. I know in no way am I going to get it. And it's not something I would ever be brave enough to do, but I just kind of took the plunge and thought, you know what, I'm going to apply to this and I know I'm going to fail. So when I don't get the job, everything is going as planned, but I got my first one out. And so I don't have to worry about it anymore. And I'm just kind of relieving myself of the pressure of having to get it and be perfect with it. And it's scary, but it's exciting.
Yay. That's awesome. Thank you for sharing. All right, Camille has her hand up.
Hi. So I am breaking up with perfect because recently I just went through a divorce after 10 years of marriage early last month, and it really just, it came out of nowhere. I didn't realize we had issues that could lead to a divorce. So it was just very shocking, humiliating. And I thought, not that we were perfect, but I just thought I had essentially the perfect life, right? And so now I'm learning what it means to just rediscover my identity, prioritize myself. Silk and Sonder has been a great touchstone and a source of comfort and a safe space, like during these last several months. And just seeing like how much of my identity was living for someone else and just breaking that up and learning, who am I? What does it mean to be independent? What do I like? How can I put myself first? Every time I fill out a Sonder survey and it's like, I joined Silk and Sonder too. And I always answer two ways, to prioritize myself or to care for myself. And so I wasn't doing that before, thinking things were perfect. And now I'm seeing, no, that wasn't perfection. I need to break up with that idea of perfection and just really prioritize me and care for me in these different fun ways that you guys provide. So,
oh my gosh, thank you so much for sharing.
That was really beautiful.
Thank you.
All right. Evangeline, would you like to share? Just make sure you unmute.
Sorry.
Oh, you're good.
Besides earlier, which usually I'm, you know, I can focus right on the socials. Like today, I had my chapter meeting and, you know, I had everything written out the way it's supposed to go. And yeah, that could have just gone in the trash. Nothing went the way it was supposed to. But on the other hand, a lot got done. At my job, I have to break up with Perfect because as much as my job, we have to be right. We cannot give the wrong medication to the wrong person because of HIPAA and the consequences that can happen. I can't be perfect because I don't know everything and all the problems with insurances, and for perfectionists, that is very difficult. So trying to break up with Perfect with that, because it's very frustrating for somebody that wants to be right all the time to not always have the answers. So I'm breaking up with Perfect in that way.
I love that. Awesome. Yeah.
It's hard not to want to be perfect all the time.
Yeah, absolutely. So that's definitely something that you have to work, you have to keep working on, right? It's not like an instantly, oh, now I've broken up with the perfect and now everything's great, right? It's like every day you have to kind of struggle with that. So we're here for you. Let us know how we can help. Jennifer O.
Another one of our facilitators.
Yes.
Hey guys, Karen, this is so much fun. I learned so much stuff. But gosh, you know, breaking up with Perfect is something that I've worked on my whole life because I really strived to be a perfect kid. I had a blended family and the steps weren't so great. And so I put a lot of pressure on myself to be a certain way, became a very loyal person to everybody in my world, very loyal, exhausted myself doing that. And so I am trying to break up with Perfect by becoming my own best friend, by giving to myself what came so easily to give to others that actually depleted me, because I was not taking care of myself. I was not going to the well. I was not filling my cup. So my identity and who I was so wrapped up into the service that I gave. I'm trying to swap that around in my retirement years and really put me first. And that's how I'm breaking up with Perfect.
Yay. That's awesome, Jennifer. Yes, Jennifer O is one of our other facilitators. So you will see her. She's going to, she will be my stage manager tomorrow for the weekly setup. So for those of you who are going to join us with the weekly setup, we will see you tomorrow. All right. We got some more hands here. Crystal, would you like to share with us?
Okay. First, breaking up with Perfect is actually raising my hand when I don't really have something prepared necessarily. I'm a criminal prosecutor for my job, so I'm used to being in trials and being in front of judges all the time, and so always being overprepared. And 2 weeks ago, we lost one of our cops, and my husband's a cop as well. And so that was really devastating. And so I wasn't putting obviously as much time into my job because I decided that grieving and working through all of those issues was more important. But I have a trial on Monday that isn't a perfect trial. There's definitely issues with it. And I'm not as prepared with everything ready to go as I usually am. But I'm also not terrified to go into the trial and just be confident in my skills that I've learned, and rely on myself without relying on like my crutches of having everything written down and my lists and everything like all written down that way. So yeah, so that's my breaking up with Perfect, is getting up in front of 60 strangers again on Monday without, you know, all of my jury questions written out and my opening statement written out and all of those kinds of things. So that is my type A perfectionism relaxing a little bit. So
well, know that we will all be cheering for you on Monday and we will all be thinking of you, and I think things will go very well. But that is hard, right? To like, when you're so used to being super prepared and knowing that you can't actually be super prepared. But I think you will do great. We all do.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And this community has literally changed my life in the 2 months that I've been a part of it. Like even my husband, my parents have commented on how much happier I am. My mental health is better. And it's honestly all to you guys. So
just yay.
Thank you to everyone who's always so supportive.
We love to hear that. We love our Sonder fam. Thank you for sharing with us. All right, we've got a couple more. Carolyn Taylor. Oh, Carolyn, we need you to unmute.
There you go. Yeah. I hope I can get through this without crying too much.
it's okay if you have to cry. Crying is okay.
Well, just even coming on here is a big step forward for me. The Sonder Club and the Sonder journals have meant so much to me. I was diagnosed just a few weeks ago with endometrial cancer. And so breaking up with Perfect for me is having to let go of a lot of responsibilities and really lean on my family and my friends. And that's hard because I'm used to doing everything. And I enjoy coming to these socials so much. They mean so much to me. They give me a lot of hope and encouragement. And I just wanted to reach out and let you guys know how much you all mean to me and how much it means for me to be a part of this community, because I don't think I could make it without you guys right now. So thank you for everything you guys all do to make these socials and everything, because again, they're like a lifeline for me right now.
So sorry to hear that, Carolyn, but we are 100% behind you and we will be rooting for you, and you come to as many socials as you can. And
I will. I might not get to cook at the next one. My surgery is the 8th of April, but if I'm conscious enough, I'll be here to at least watch.
You can, yes, you absolutely can come. And that's the other thing with these cooking socials, or really any of the socials. If you're like, I can't actually do the prompts, I can't actually do the writing, but you just want to hang out with us, you are always welcome to come and just hang out. Absolutely, 100%. We are here for you.
Thank you.
So we will be thinking of you.
Thanks. I appreciate it.
Now I'm the one who's crying.
All right, we've got one more hand up. Is it Chevron? Am I pronouncing that right?
Siobhan.
Siobhan.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. And I just want to say much love, sending love to everyone who has already spoken today. The way that I've only been a part of Sonder for 2 weeks, so really just for March here, but I'm enjoying it. And the way that I'm breaking up with Perfect is my best friend, who, you know, my mother, who also is my best friend, she passed away a few months ago. And the grieving process I'm learning is not cookie cutter at all. And I'm breaking up with Perfect because I'm allowing myself to, you know, giving myself grace, you know, because I'm experiencing all sorts of never experienced before things and feelings and, you know, like that I've just never had to deal with, like, you know, like just recently having like random like panic attacks. And I'm like, man, this is just really crazy. I'm like, what in the world is wrong with me? But I'm giving myself grace because it's literally the most traumatic thing that's ever happened in my life. So that's how I'm breaking up with Perfect. It's like allowing myself the grace to go through the grieving process and being kinder and more gentle with myself, which is why I joined Sonder to begin with. Just want to be more intentional about self-care, which I feel will assist me with being able to go through the grieving process as best I can. So thank you, everyone. I appreciate it.
I know how hard it is. I lost, those of you who've been to some of my other socials know, my dad died of a heart attack in the day my mom was supposed to start chemotherapy. And then she lived a couple of years past that, and I became her caretaker. And the panic attacks happened for me too, including at one point a hallucination that someone had broken in to my apartment. Thank God it was just a hallucination. But that stuff is real. And if we don't deal with it, it's going to show up in other ways. Migraines started to manifest, psoriasis breakouts. So you're absolutely doing the right thing, and much love to you during this lifelong journey of grief.
All right, I think we've gotten everybody who had their hands up.
Anybody else? And if you are not comfortable coming on camera, feel free to put it into the chat and I will be your words, and I may not make it through crying or not.
I know, we always joke that, you know, come to the Sonder social and bring your journal and something to write with and something to drink and a box of tissues. Right? Because there's so many times, you know, when it's just like, oh, it's just too much. Right. And so I really appreciate people sharing. I know Karen does too. We appreciate people. I mean, it's okay to cry, right? There's nothing, it doesn't mean you're too emotional. It doesn't mean you're, you know, not able to function or whatever, right? Like we're, yeah, I saw Amber made a comment, we're all a bunch of criers and Silk and Sonder, but it's funny because my dad used to always say, it's good for you to cry, it washes your eyes out. so think you can think of it that way too, but it's very cathartic to be able to do that. I know we have a lot of folks who are dealing with, you know, grief. We all collectively, these last 2 years, what we've all been through has just been trauma. So we're so happy when you can come and be with us and share stories and make some arugula salads.
So Melissa popped on and she says she's breaking up with the Perfect by trying to be graceful with herself with incontinence issues. Girl, I mean, as we age, it just happens. I haven't even had kids and I sneeze and cross my legs. I'm trying to go to a Pilates class on Monday and I'm so scared to do it. I'm breaking up with trying to be perfect and my fear of trying something new. You're going to love it. Melissa, reach out to me via Facebook if you want to talk about what to expect in a Pilates class. It's Karen, and feel free to, any of you guys, friend me, message me. I know we don't have that capability yet in the app, but it's Karen Lovelace, and I'm more than happy to talk anyone through what to expect when they come into a Pilates class. And it's absolutely normal when going into a class to feel very nervous. I always go to people I know when I'm willing to go into a class the first time, because I'm a bit of a chicken that way too. So I'm really proud of you for taking a step for your physical, mental health, because Pilates is a lot of mind-body connection, and you're gonna love it. You're gonna absolutely love it. Let's see if anybody else. Amber says that she's going to make this trip. quick, but in October, I had a full-on mental health crisis and had to miss work for a month and get treatment. And part of the treatment is what led me to Silk and Saunders. The first half of the treatment, I spent in a frenzy about having to miss work because that's just not a thing I do. And so many people are relying on me. But by the end, I learned that work is just work and I have to put myself first. Absolutely. I mean, I had a boss who's like, everybody's replaceable, right? And it doesn't feel good to think of it that way, but it absolutely is. But guess what? We got one life. That's it. And so we have to put ourselves first. That job is very tempting to put yourself on the back burner like I have in the last week. I have yet to do a ritual in March. And after this, I'm going to open up that Prosecco. I'm going to sit down with my earphones and I'm going to start pushing through and taking some of those things off my plate to get back to what it is I need to be functioning. So I'm so proud of you. I'm proud of what it is that you're doing. So let's see. I think
we've got Nora had just posted, starting a new teaching job on Monday. I am also in K-12 education. I also teach in higher ed. So I'm right there with all my teaching friends. And I know Karen has a lot of experience with teaching as well. And she's trying to break up with the perfect by not trying to be so hard on herself and knowing that I will make mistakes and it won't be the end of the world. It will be okay. I can move on and learn from my mistakes. Absolutely. 100%.
None of us are perfect. And there's not, when you're working with kids, there's no right or wrong way. And there's no magic formula because they're their own little person. And so I know that I made mistakes all the time when I was in the classroom, and that what made the difference for me and some of the other teachers that didn't do this is that when I messed up, I admitted it to that child and to the rest of the class, and it made it a safe place for them to make mistakes as well as myself. And it definitely is very powerful to admit that. And as adults, sometimes it's hard to do that. See if there's anything else. Kim was saying she ripped the posterior tendon in her foot and then tripped over the cast in September, was on bed rest for weeks, and then had a cancer scare in December, which was just put to bed last week. Oh gosh, that is a lot. And I've learned to let go and breathe. Isn't breath a wonderful, powerful thing? And Kim said she would have talked, but her boxer is behind it. And you can hear my husband rustling around in the background. Carolyn said, it's really taught me how important it is to take care of yourself and learn to put, it's okay to put ourselves first. How can we care for others if we're not taking care of ourselves? Yes. And then let's see. Tanya says she's breaking up with perfect by not trying to please everyone else. For the first time in my life, I'm focusing on what I truly want and need. And Silk and Saunders is a big reason for that. Wow, you guys have been amazing. I think this is ultimately where we're going to, we got someone else. Vienna saying, I'm breaking up with perfect by not having a plan. Silk and Saunders inspired me to back to school 20 years later, and I have no idea what I'm doing, but what an amazing adventure. I belong to a group, and there's this woman who was sharing her story that she wanted to study art in Italy at the time of 18. She's now in her 60s. She submitted her portfolio last year. It wasn't accepted, and she did it again this year, and it was. And so she is off for 3 years in her 60s to a new place, a new career, and everything else. And I just think that's so inspiring.
Oh my gosh, that's awesome. How cool is that? I mean, that's the other thing to think of too, is right, like you're never too old and it's never too late to start something, especially something that you've always wanted. So Lee's saying, Lee once again is making that press for the in-person Sonder conference, right? Which would be great, because then we could all hug each other and share our boxes of tissue.
I know. I think we all want to be able to meet in real life. And yeah, there's definitely conversations of doing something virtual in the meantime until we can do something bigger as a group. But yeah, I think it would be amazing. And I want to be a facilitator as well as a participant in that. Okay, I'm going to give a last call for anybody else who might want to put their hand up or put something in the chat. And if I don't see anything in a little couple of moments, we're going to go out with an Elvis Presley salad song.
Get my slideshow back up here. You will be getting survey, and I'm also going to put up the slide that will have the QR code that you can scan to pop in and take the survey. Oh, and Lee's reminding you to make sure to give Petey the treats that he missed. He'd be so sad if he didn't get those treats. Next month, we will have our cooking social on the 9th. And it will be, this should be very interesting. It will be jackfruit carnitas tacos.
I love jackfruit, so I'm very much looking forward to it. It's one of my favorite meat substitutions. If you haven't used it before, it does take on the consistency of like a pulled pork. It's delicious.
And I'm so excited to try that. All right, so let me get screen up here. Thank you all so much for being here, and we will see you again soon.
Some y'all never been down south too much. Some y'all never been down south too much. I'm gonna tell you a little story so that you'll understand what I'm talking about. Down there we have a plant that grows out in the woods and the fields, and it looks something like a turnip green. Everybody calls it poke salad. Now that's poke salad. Used to know a girl lived down there, and she'd go out in the evenings and pick a mess of it, carry it home and cook it for supper, because that's about all they had to eat. But they did all right. Down in Louisiana, where the alligators grow so mean, lived a girl that I swear to the world made the alligators look tame. Oh, Saturday. Everybody said it was a shame, because the mama was a working on the chain gang of mean, vicious woman. Every day before supper time, she'd go down by the truck patch and pick her a mess of poke salad. She's a toting woman. Lord have mercy. You suck a little poke salad to me. So what? But daddy was lazy and no count. Truck fast poke salad, Annie. He just got you ready. Everybody said it was a shame, because the mama was a working on the chain gang. Hey! You suck a little poke salad to me. You know what need to be.